corner on the organ, everyone. Thank you, Steve. Welcome to the Penny Stamps Distinguished Speaker Series. For all of you who are new, I know we have a lot of new people I've never seen in the House. Fantastic to have you with us. Hope you come back often. Welcome back to all of our students. Top of a new season. For those of you who are new, I just want to let you know who we are and how we got here. We're the Penny Stamps Distinguished Speaker Series. We happen here at the Michigan Theater most every Thursday from September through April. The name is not only a great name, it is the name of a great woman who's the patroness of our series, who conceived of this as a way for students at the School of Art and Design and faculty to have a way of connecting with creative leaders out there in the real world. And lucky for you, it is an open class for the community. So you are free to join us every Thursday. Being our opening event of the year, I just wanted to take a moment to give you some thoughts on the title of the season, Acts of Translation. All acts of translation are acts of communication, be it verbal, physical, visual, musical, spatial, emotional, or even animal behavior, as we're going to hear about today. The progress of our civilization is based on our ability to communicate our own individual perceptions of the world around us. Communication lifts barriers between us. It illuminates understanding and heightens our sensitivity and awareness of things outside of ourselves, brings the other into our view. Things gaining meaning through association. Translation cultivates associative thinking, which is this that I find is the foundation of creativity, which is what we want to hear a lot about this year. So as we listen to the Penny Stamp speakers share their creations and translate their perceptions to us, we should leave behind our own preconceived notions and keenly observe and remember that once an idea is released into the world, it has a power all its own, and that the idea itself is not the end result, but rather this is the beginning of the transformation that it has the power to propel. It's like planting a seed in your garden. And we can engage these acts of translation in our own frame of reference, our own context, our own structures of perception, and help them to grow. Because after all, the danger of knowledge is that we'll learn from it. And the power of communication is that we can learn from each other. Ideas beget ideas, and it's ideas that change the world. And we have a lot of folks in here that can communicate together about all this. So each week at the Penny Stamp series, through moments of direct encounters with the presenters and their ideas, but most of all with each other here, we should dare to listen and be prepared to interpret and share our own deductions, paving the way for our very own acts of translation. So I hope you can all gather up for this big journey. We have a great dynamic season for you. I know that I had a lot of calendars out in the lobby and we ran out. I apologize. If you didn't get one, I have a few more that I'll put out that you can get at the end. And I'll bring lots more next week. So you should join us again next week. You can find us online at art-design.umich.edu/stamps. Or we're on Facebook at Penny Stamps Lecture Series. Or just come here Thursdays, 5:10 p.m., Michigan Theater, same time, same place. Today, we are very pleased to present the doctor of animal science, designer, and author, Temple Grandin. Yeah. Yay. And I want to give a big thank you to our partners for their support of this presentation, the University of Michigan Autism and Communication Disorders Center, Arts at Michigan's Passport to the Arts program, and Michigan Radio WUOM 91.7. Thank you. It takes all of us. We will be having a question and answer session after the lecture. This will not happen in this room. This will happen in the theater screening room, which for those of you that don't know, you can exit the theater, take a left, go down the long hallway, and you'll find yourself in another lobby of a smaller screening room. So we'll have a little moment of a question and answer with Temple in there. Nicholas Books is here in the lobby. Temple has written an awful good number of books, and you should buy up the books that we have, because then she will sign them after the Q&A in the screening room lobby. So now, for a proper introduction of Temple and her work, I'm very pleased to introduce you to the woman who first brought Temple Grandin to my attention 5 years ago when she was first nominated for the series. We have worked on Temple 5 years to get here. This came from Associate Professor of Art and Design, Women's Studies, and Theater Art, Holly Hughes.
Thanks, Christina. Happy New Year. Yeah. Good Yontif. And my New Year gift to you is that I'm going to give you a very short introduction about Temple Grandin, so you have more time with the actual Temple Grandin. This isn't going to be one of those introductions that tells you everything she did or is doing. That would take more than the hour we have available to us, and you can look it up on your own time. But you know, I'm sure you wouldn't be here, that she's a pioneer in so many different ways. She is a pioneer as a woman in the science field. I asked her what it was like to get a PhD in the 80s in animal science, and she said, awful. She doesn't, you know, use extra words if she doesn't have to. As a person with autism who's made important contributions in a number of different fields, she's also, as Christina mentioned, a designer, an inventor, and over lunch today, we turned to her and said, Temple, has anyone ever done an exhibition of your drawings and your inventions? And she said, well, a small one. And I thought, so immediately Christina and I started thinking, we need to have a solo show of Temple Grandin's visual work here at the University of Michigan. We're going to wake up and make that happen. So all of those different contributions that Temple has made, and in the wake of all of her notoriety, which has been building up for years, she was probably first came to a lot of people's attention when her story was captured by Oliver Sacks. The title story in his book, An Anthropologist on Mars, which is Temple's response to Dr. Sacks' question, what does it feel to be around people without autism or neurotypicals? And she said, I feel like an anthropologist on Mars. She has also thought and continues to think very deeply about our relationship and obligations and responsibilities for the domestic animals that we have. She has waded into that very charged waters and has been very brave and made important contributions. Here's a quote from her. I think using animals for food is an ethical thing to do, but we've got to do it right. We've got to give these animals a decent life and a painless death. We owe the animal respect. Dr. Temple Grandin.
Well, it's really great to be here tonight. I've got to just start out and just probably talking about a whole lot of different things. In fact, since I was brought here by the art department, I was actually going to spend more time talking about design than about animals. But I probably have to get a few animal things in there. But what I want to get you thinking about is different kinds of thinking. You know, to understand an animal, you've got to get away from language. Understand mathematics, you kind of get away from verbal language. To understand art, there's a whole world of sensory-based thinking. It's one of the big things I was going to want to talk about tonight is different kinds of thinking. And an animal's world is sensory-based. You know, and I have found that, you know, some people are very much thinking words, others kind of thinking pictures. I think in pictures. My mind's kind of like Google for images. And it takes a lot of different people doing a lot of different kinds of thinking to work together. You know, different kinds of minds are good at different kinds of things. I had a graduate student, and she was good at everything I was bad at. And we worked just great together as a team. But I want to get you to imagine a world of pictures, sounds, taste, and touch. And if you imagine that, then you can understand animals a whole lot better. Now, I want to show you that it's kind of a world of other kinds of thinking underneath language. Some mathematicians got a hold of Van Gogh's Starry Night, and they mathematically analyzed these swirls, and they found out that they matched a statistical model of turbulence in water flow. I don't think Van Gogh was planning that out when he did this picture. This brings up another kind of thinking, thinking in patterns. I have found that there's kind of like different kinds of autistic specialist minds. There's a photorealistic visual thinker like me, there's a pattern thinker, and there's also a word thinker. Now there's a type of Alzheimer's where as the language parts of the brain get wrecked, art ability will come out of somebody that has no previous knowledge of art. And this painting was published in the Journal of Neurology by Dr. Bruce Miller. And this person had maybe, some of the patients he'd had, had jobs like installing stereos in cars. They had absolutely no interest in art. Language covers up visual thinking, maybe some of the mathematical thinking. You know, there's a lot of different kinds of thinking out there. I want you to get to think about thinking. Now, one thing that's true in a lot of people on the autism spectrum is they're into details, okay? This is a test that tests, do you tend to see the whole gestalt or do you tend to look at details? So you've got big letters made out of little letters. And if you flash these up one at a time and you say, pick out the little letters or pick out the big letters, the person with autism will pick out the little letters much more quickly. You know, it's a few milliseconds quicker. I did this test on a laptop. I thought it was the same on both, but I picked out the little letters quicker. Now, some of you might be wondering, what exactly is autism? It's a very big continuum. First of all, it's a neurological disorder. It's not psychological. It has to do with brain development. And it varies all the way from geniuses in Silicon Valley and famous artists. In fact, you know, people like Einstein and Mozart, in a lot of school systems would be labeled autistic today, or maybe dyslexic, or some other kind of label. And then as you move down the continuum, you've got people that remain nonverbal, that have a lot more problems. You know, when does a geek or a nerd turn into mild autism? There's no black and white dividing line. It is a true continuum. That's what the research is showing. And in the autistic brain, some social circuits get left out. But then that leaves some extra circuits in there for all the good geek stuff I like. And I have to say that one of the things I really liked in the HBO movie they did about me was they absolutely duplicated all my projects. That was very, very accurate. And they used my real drawings in there in that conference room scene. I was really turned on by that. I was only 15 years old when I figured out how to build that gate. Incidentally, I do have to say the movie's out on DVD now. Just had to say that. But one of the things that I want to try to get people to think about is sort of different ways of thinking, different ways of solving problems. Some brain scan research done by Dr. Nancy Minshew at the University of Pittsburgh showed that normal people tend to drop out the details. Let's just give an example of that. Let's say you read a sentence about, just anything, start reading out of a book. The autistic mind picks out the details of the words. The Asperger mind, kind of a mild autism, they get the details and the syntax. But the normal mind just gets the gist of the whole thing and leaves out the details. Well, the problem is, if you're an engineer and you're designing a bridge, and you leave out a little detail, like on the size of the steel you use, that bridge might fall down. That's kind of a rather important little detail. And I have found I'm working on troubleshooting, whether it's a dog behavior problem, or it's maybe a problem with a child with autism, or some other problem at school, is people tend to get too vague. They'll say something like, well, my kid has behavior issues in the classroom. Well, what's a behavior issue in the classroom? You see, I see pictures. Is he throwing spitballs? Or did he, attack the teacher? I might deal with those two different kinds of things totally differently. Those would both be a behavior issue in the classroom. I find I got to get in there and question, because I got to figure out exactly what the behavior is. Now, in my early work with animals, I noticed that cattle were afraid of things we don't notice. Like, here's a flag right near the entrance to a cattle handling area where cattle get vaccinated. They didn't want to walk into this chute because they could see the flag they're waving. And when I first started noticing these things back in the 70s, people thought that was just absolutely really crazy. Why would you be looking at what cattle look at? Well, I thought it made a lot of sense, because cattle would point their eyes and ears right towards stuff they were afraid of. They'd stop and put their head down. And here's an animal walking out of the chute after being vaccinated, and he's looking right at a beam of sunlight on the ground. Now, one question I get asked all the time, are cattle and pigs afraid of getting slaughtered? I had to answer that question really early in my career. So I'd go over to the Swift plant in Arizona in the early 70s and I'd watch cattle going up the ramp at the Swift plant. Then I'd go down to a feed yard and watch them vaccinate cattle. And they behaved the same way in both places. No, you had to get rid of all the distractions that they were seeing. Like, for example, in this chute, this happens to be out on a ranch, I got down in this chute and look at the shadows you've got there. On a sunny day, you have shadows. Or maybe on a really bright sunny day, it's really dark inside the building. They don't like walking into the dark. That's like going into the dark, a movie theater kind of effect. And I found if I got rid of these distractions, then they'd walk right in. And the behavior was very similar. Also, this plant only had a 5-foot, 6-inch fence. The kind of cattle we had in Arizona, striped Brahma cross cattle, those cattle could have jumped that fence without even thinking about it. They knew they were going to get slaughtered. They should have been jumping out. But they weren't. And they could have also jumped out of the trucks we had. We had these old trucks that were open on the top, and they never jumped out of them. You know, and I was one of the first people to see that detail, sensory detail. That's what the animals were looking at. Okay, they're coming up here. They can see people through the fence. You know, might see vehicles going by. What are they seeing? Now, this seems obvious. But I'm finding even today, after being talking about these things for 35 years, when I do a cattle handling lecture, I still have to show a picture of a piece of chain hanging down in the chute and say, take it out. Why do I have to keep showing that? Because people don't take it out. It's like I gotta give them checklists. I now on my webpage have written checklists, all the things where they can verbally go down it and get rid of the things that scare cattle. Now notice how the horse and the zebra have an ear on each other. And then the other ear is on me. And one thing, the movie had a great scene in there showing which way the horse's ears go. You got to be observant. What I want to try to do is to get you to enter a more sensory-based kind of world. And originally, I don't have my slides in here for talking about animal issues, because since this was the art department, I thought I wanted to talk, I was originally told to talk a lot more about, about visual thinking and how that relates to art and engineering and things of this sort. And I think I might just digress for just a second here. And when I first started out on designing animal handling facilities, I'm going to show some slides of some of these. Don't worry, there's no gory pictures. I left those at home. Well, actually, I got some of them in my briefcase, but they're not in this computer. That's for sure. And I thought I could fix everything with equipment. I thought I could build the perfect system and then fix all the problems. I can only fix half the problems with equipment. The other half is management. So the big thing I've been working on now is auditing. We got to measure handling. How many animals are mooing and bellowing during handling? Well, if you want to pass a McDonald's audit and you're one of the big plants, you only allowed 3 cattle out of 100 mooing and bellowing going up into the stun box. Only 1 out of 100 can fall. The plants now have to maintain equipment better. Yes, there's still problems out there. And a lot of the nastiest videos that are out there, the places are not being audited. Like the 3 worst videos I can think of are outside the audit system. But we've got to be measuring, because we've got to make people manage stuff. Let's get back to management. You know, a lot of people thought, oh, we put internet in the schools, that's instantly going to make all the schools absolutely wonderful. It didn't. And now half of some kids are probably playing video games on them. And I'm saying way too many kids get so addicted to video games that they don't want to do anything else. Now, what is thinking in pictures? Thinking in pictures is having movies in your head. Now, this is old 16 millimeter movie reels. Some people might not know what those are. They are movie reels. But it's literally pictures in your head, because when I think of something, I get a picture. You see, for me, no photorealistic picture in my head, no thought. So if I think about a problem like healthcare, for example, I don't think about it in the abstract. I think one of the big problems we've got in government and stuff today, it's all too abstract and ideological. I see, I'm now seeing a picture in my mind of a truck driver that had to pull a tooth out with pliers because he couldn't afford a root canal. I read about that in the paper. Now I'm visualizing it and I'm feeling it. Or a lady who broke her foot and she couldn't afford to go to the doctor and get it x-rayed. You see, I see specific things. See, to me, healthcare problems are all specific examples. Now, I realized my thinking was different when I wrote my book, Thinking in Pictures, back in 1995, when I started asking people about church steeples. Well, why church steeples? I wanted to pick out an object that everybody sees every day, but they don't really pay attention to them. And this is when I found out that my visual thinking was different than a lot of other people's visual thinking. And visual thinking is a continuum. It's not, you know, and there's a lot of non-autistic people that are visual thinkers. There's people with other learning disabled labels that are visual thinkers. Now, I was shocked when I asked people to think about a church steeple that most people got this vague generalized one. You see, in my mind, there is no generalized one. There's only specific ones. And I start naming off where they're at. Now I've learned from reading the neuroscience literature that I am going into the primary graphics files in the brain, where most other people are going into association cortex, where you're kind of merging images together into general principles. And if I ask you house or car, most people can see their own house or car. But when I ask you something you're not so familiar with, you know, maybe a boat, maybe you know, maybe some other, you know, thing, you don't, you see it all the time, tree. Even tree, I see specific ones. Okay, I only see specific ones, and they flash up like Google for images. There's a great scene in the movie where it shows a bunch of shoes coming up in rapid succession. The movie shows exactly how I think. It also showed the anxiety really well, and it showed the sensory sensitivity problems. It's very, very clinically accurate. Claire Danes became me back in the 60s and 70s. She also became me before I took antidepressant medication. I've been on antidepressant medication for 30 years, and it stopped the horrible anxiety attacks. And I have a whole section of Thinking in Pictures all about that. And I really was eating yogurt and Jell-O. And I would be eating it for maybe you know, a week at a time, and then I could wean myself back onto regular food again. And then the antidepressants kind of made that problem go away. Oh, don't. Okay, now what I want to show you here, this computer's a little bit on the slow side, is how these pictures go into my mind, and this computer's probably not going to like it. You see, you got start out with local ones, then you can get famous ones, and they just come up as a series of pictures. That's how my mind works. They come up sequentially. They don't come up like Google, the way Google puts it out now. They're all in like big rows. It doesn't come out that way. They come up sequentially. Now, visual thinking really, really, really helped me. Is that here a cell phone that I'd like to step on and crush it like a roach? Now, the thing about being a visual thinker is when I design something, I could see it in my mind and I could test run it. I thought everybody could test run equipment in their mind. Now, one of the things I had to learn how to do is how to relate the lines on a drawing with the actual real thing. And one of the things that really helped me is I got the whole big drawing for the Swift plant, the entire Swift plant. It had the parking lot on it, it had the water tower, it had all the equipment on it, everything. And I spent 2 days walking around that plant until every line on that drawing could be related to a piece of, you know, something real. Like a square on the drawing was a concrete column that held up the building. A round circle was the water tower. You know, I had to take these things that were, you know, symbolic things and make it concrete and real. And that's a picture, aerial view of the dip vat that was recreated for the movie. And that was really, I have to say, that really was a trip. And there's one of my drawings. And people really thought I was weird. And it's a little blurry. I'm sorry. It was electronically scanned, and it's probably not the best scan. But people thought I was really weird. When they think you're really weird, what I had to do was make a portfolio of work to show people how my thinking, you know, show the world of things I could really do. I had to sell my work. And this is a hand-drawn drawing. And I've made some very interesting observations, you know, as the industry switched from hand drawings to the computer about drawing ability. The people that went from hand drawing to computers, their computer drawings are fine. But a young person that came in that never spilled anything with their hands and they've never drawn by hand, they're making a lot of odd mistakes on drawings. I'm going to come back a little bit to that later. See, the thing is if you don't ever take a compass and actually make a circle, you don't really understand where the center of the circle is. I got drawings from every major meat company with weird, weird mistakes on them that never happened back in the hand drawing days. Now, I'm not suggesting going back to hand drawing, but people need to build things with their hands. I was just reading an article in Scientific American about how babies learn to perceive by touch, and they're not seeing their drawings right. There's a drawing of the dip vat. They used this drawing to build the set in the movie. And then in my class, I teach a class in livestock equipment design, and one of the things I really emphasize to my students is even if you're never going to design a cattle handling facility, I want you to understand how a drawing relates to a real thing. Because and the other thing is, I have them lay out things and design it, there's no absolutely right answer. And I take all the best drawings, there might be 10 different ways you could lay it out that all work, as long as they follow certain rules of layout. We've got to teach problem-solving skills. So this just shows a basic layout for drawing on a ranch for doing, you know, vaccinations of cattle, and there's the actual thing. And I actually switch them back and forth like this in the class so they can see how they relate to each other. Here are some of the perceptual mistakes I've seen on the computer-aided drawings. Radius point of the circle is not in the center of the circle. That is in the center of the circle. And these came from major companies. Another place had 25-foot-long gates. How can you make 25-foot-long gates work? There's no way you can make that work. Now, if you just looked at the drawing really fast, it looked okay. But when I put my scale ruler on it, I go, wait a minute, 25-foot-long gates, it's not going to work. Uneven alley widths. And then they'd have gates that didn't swing correctly because they didn't even use the compass function that's in the computer to swing the gates right. And I have a person who works for me now named Mark, and he does a fantastic job doing most of the cattle design work now. I had him on a hand drafting table for an entire year before we got anywhere near computers. And he has had computer instructors say to him, well, how did your CAD drawings get to be so good? Well, because he learned hand drafting first. And then after he got back from drafting computer school, they hadn't taught him how to use any of the things that are on the computer that relate to hand drafting, like the compass function. So we sat down there and we went through all the little icons, the French curve icon and the circle drawing thing. And we found out that every one of these drawings, these messed up drawings, came from someone really young. They had never built anything with their hands, and they had never drawn by hand. Every single major meat company. Now, you're talking about things that if you actually built things from some of these drawings, if I hadn't looked at it and caught the mistakes, it would have been a real mess. Now, some little kids that are on the autism spectrum, when they're very young, will draw in perspective. Most little kids don't draw in perspective. And here's a drawing I got from a 9-year-old. We've got to work on developing strengths. There's a lot of quirky kids out there, geeky kids, quirky kids, dyslexic kids. They got various different things. And skills are going to be uneven. Good at one thing, bad at something else. Everything was done to promote my ability in art. If I hadn't had art when I was in elementary school, I would have been really, really miserable. And I used my art skill in my design work. Now, I used to joke around that I had a huge internet trunk line in my head for graphics, like a really big graphics card. And this is a scan that was done by Nancy Minshew and Marcel Just at the University of Pittsburgh. Yep, I got a giant internet graphics line. But I want to tell you, other people on the spectrum don't all have this. Because some of the people on the autism spectrum are a word thinker. So they don't have this great big trunk line. And there, another slice taken up here, and I got a real big one there, and that one goes all the way back to primary visual cortex, and the other one there, the blue line's not going back as far. I'm all the way back into like the picture files, because my thinking's all photorealistic. Now, there's another kind of mind. I call it the pattern thinker. These are your mathematicians. These are people that can program computers really well. It's visual thinking, but it's more abstract. And this praying mantis is extreme origami. He's made from a single sheet of folded paper. There's no cutting, there's no scotch taping, and what you see in the background there is the folding pattern for making the praying mantis. This is the work of Robert Lang. You might want to look that up on the internet if you're interested. All kinds of fantastic little beasties he's making out of single sheets of folded paper. This is not my mind. This is a different kind of mind. I'm not good at these kind of things. I'm also finding that there's some kids that can do geometry and trig, and they're hopeless at algebra. I was hopeless at algebra. I never got a chance to do geometry or trig. Gigantic mistake. You know, algebra is not the prerequisite for geometry and trig if you've got this pattern thinking kind of mind. And when I bring this up at conferences, they just come out of the woodwork in droves. Here are different types of thinking. Photorealistic visual thinkers can't do algebra. The pattern thinkers, these are your music minds. Music is patterns. Your math minds, your engineering minds, your programming minds, the verbal mind, often poor at drawing. And then I had a student that was an auditory thinker, because she had visual processing problems, where her visual system would, she'd see print jiggling on the page, and she learned everything auditory. And when she studied animal behavior, she'd listen to what animals sounded like in different situations. Now, how do you think? Because when thinking so specific, if I got all these pictures in my mind like Google for images, how do I form a concept? You have to form a concept by putting specific pictures into file folders in the brain. And this is a picture a young autistic man sent to me, and he's sorting cats and dogs into different boxes in the brain. It's what's called bottom-up thinking. You know, most people think top-down. You form a theory, and then you try to shove all the data into it. Mine is bottom-up. I form my theories by looking at the data, and I sort specific things into categories. That's how I think. A dog, for example, has two different categories. His behavior: for on the leash, I protect my owner. Off the leash, I can go play with other dogs. From on the leash, maybe I need to bite other dogs. That's an example of setting up file folders. If you want to teach a severely autistic kid not to run across the street, you better teach him in 10 different places. Otherwise, he might think it just applies to home. Man on a horse, man on the ground. The horse will perceive that as two different things. Cattle do the same thing. A horse that's maybe been abused by a rider will like buck and be terrible when you ride him, but he may be fine for shoeing and veterinary work. You see, on the ground, on the horse, see, it's two different things. See, that's what you see. It's much more specific. I want to try to get you thinking more specific. That's going to help solve a lot of problems. One of the big problems we've got today is everybody in the government just fights, and we're not getting stuff done. We're getting too far away from practical things. I know you young people that, hey, don't want to hear about old fogies talking about what happened in the 50s and the 60s, but let me tell you, in the 50s, the Republicans built the interstate highway system, and the Democrats went to the moon in the 60s. That was really, 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 really cool stuff. We need to get back to doing more cool stuff, because that's how we're going to solve things like environmental problems and global warming and find new energy sources. We got to have people doing stuff, not just becoming lawyers and suing everybody. We got to figure out how to fix stuff. Now, both animals and people on the autism spectrum are bottom-up thinkers. In other words, you take specific information, put it together into categories to form a concept. So how did I learn specific concept? Lots of different examples, put them into file folders that are in my mind. That it's, you know, other ways you have a theory and then you try to cram the data into it. And one of the problems we have today is a lot of people that are making policy are getting too far away from the thing they're making policy about. It's not transmitting down into the ground into something that works. Okay. Here's an example of teaching a concept with specific examples to a young child with autism. Up. A kite goes up in the air. You can walk up the stairs, walk up a hill, go up in the attic, lift up a cup. And I can demonstrate that all. And I see a picture in my mind for each one of those things. Well, walking up the hill, I actually saw a hill next door to my house where I would take the toboggan out and go on it, fly a kite up in the air. I used to fly a kite on that same field. Teaching math concepts. Teach them to count many different kinds of objects, pennies, bottle caps, paper cups, toy dinosaurs. You know, that concept applies to a lot of different things. Teach, you know, liquid concepts. Well, this bottle of water has less water in it than this full bottle of water. Okay, now I just drink some of this. Now I've got about 3/4 of a bottle of water left. You know, and teach it, you know, cut up, you know, a cake or something like that, or pie, so they can cut an apple up, you know, to teach different, you know, proportionality. This horse was scared to death of black cowboy hats because somebody wearing a black cowboy hat abused this horse. You see, he associated the thing he was looking at when he was badly treated. White cowboy hat's fine, black cowboy hat's bad. And when it was on the ground, it wasn't quite so scary. And then the closer the black hat got to my head, the more scary it got. We've got to take the different kinds of minds and get people working together. You know, and I'm very concerned that an awful lot of these quirky, nerdy kids are not ending up in Silicon Valley. Yeah, they're not that social. You know, we need, and the movie did a great job of showing my science teacher, who really mentored me, really, really helped me. If I hadn't had him, I wouldn't have been motivated to go on and study. But you got to show kids interesting stuff. And the movie showed the actual Bell Labs film that I watched in high school that got me turned on to making that distorted room illusion. I spent 6 months doing that. And it made me happy to find out that the set designers had a really hard time building that, even though they had the drawings for it. I want you to think about different ways of thinking, you know, and how people with different kinds of minds can work together and do stuff and solve problems. We need to help the students that have different kinds of minds to be successful. We're not doing enough thinking about what kids are going to do when they grow up. You know, when I was 13 years old, one of my first jobs was hemming dresses for a seamstress that did freelance sewing. I'm seeing too many kids today that they don't have any, they're not getting any work skills. You know, if they're lucky enough to be out in Silicon Valley, they get apprenticed into that by their parents. But I'm seeing too many smart, geeky kids in Kansas ending up on, you know, bagging groceries. That's not what they ought to be doing. And I've had people say to me, well, there's nothing for this kid to do in Kansas. I go, yes, there is. There's feedlots. Where do you think I got started? I got started in the feedlots. There's lots of interesting stuff. All kinds of agricultural equipment, irrigation, and power, you know, generating stations. There's lots of interesting stuff in Kansas. You know, and mentors are essential. And mentors don't necessarily have to be just in science. It could be an English teacher, it could be a math teacher, it could be, you know, many different kinds of teachers. Good teachers can really get kids turned around. And then let's say you have a teenager that's kind of headed into a bunch of trouble. There's a lot of retired people that might want to mentor a kid in engineering. And it doesn't matter if the thing you teach the kid is something old. You know, let's say you taught a kid some ancient old kind of computer programming. That doesn't matter. Because what you're doing is you're turning on the spark. Or maybe an artist works with a young kid, you know, instead of like making a mess back here behind the theater on the graffiti wall, you know, let's get the kid in and do teach them some real serious art, because they've got to learn how to do assignments, not just be scribbling all over everything. They've got to start learning how to do art that they can use that as a career. I think it's a shame that so many schools have taken out the hands-on classes. I think it's a gigantic, huge mistake. When I was in elementary school, of course, this was the 50s, girls learned sewing. I took embroidery class. I loved embroidery class. And I also loved art class. Hated cooking. And me and my friend Eleanor, we were the first ones to get out of cooking and get to take wood shop. And then in high school, I did all kinds of building stuff. I took care of horses. If I hadn't had hands-on things, I just would have been dead. Well, I took sewing, too. I actually went to dressmaking class. I liked sewing very much. I had a toy sewing machine in the fourth grade, and I had a real one when I was in about seventh grade. You know, and, you know, you learn problem solving, and there's nothing simple about a simplicity pattern, I can tell you right now. They ought to be calling those... I got a new name for them, complexity patterns. But practical things teach problem-solving skills. They also teach you that things don't always come out right. I ruined a pair of pants one time. I cut the fabric wrong. I had to throw the whole project out. You know, sometimes that happens. We got to give the different kinds of minds opportunity. You know, we need to be hiring them, mentoring them, working with them, and developing them. Art class, that was my salvation. Those are just some pictures that I scanned out of my high school scrapbook. Okay, I want to talk about some things that can really mess up kids, and that can be things that can sometimes really be fixed relatively easily, and that's sensory processing disorder. I had a lot of problems with sound sensitivity. Loud noises hurt like a dentist drill. There's other people that have visual processing problems, even though they can drive and they're not blind. When they go to read, the print jiggles on the page. Fluorescent lights are flickering on and off like a discotheque. And you can have these problems with many, many different, you know, labels. And for the visual processing problem, where the print jiggles, you know what can sometimes fix that? You can try on some of the old hippie glasses, the pale pink ones, the pale purple ones, pale yellow, orange. Just try on all the different pale colors until you find the ones with print no longer jiggles. How does that work? Why does it work? Nobody knows why it works. It has something to do with what's called the binding problem in the brain. The binding problem is one of the biggest brain research mysteries. How does the brain make a graphics file? We know that the brain has color, shape, and motion circuits. We know that. How do they work together to form an image? Something's wrong with that. And the images aren't binding together right. And why colored glasses might help, I don't know. But the important thing is picking just the right color. Well, and that's a picture of a little boy covering up his ears. I mean, sound sensitivity problems, they can be really real. You know, sometimes you can get a child over this by getting him to play it on a recording device at a low volume where he initiates the sound. Another problem that brains with problems have is attention shifting slowness. One of the reasons why I hate the cell phone so much in the audience is that attracts my attention. And then it takes me a long time to get my thoughts back because attention just takes longer. Multitasking, forget it. Even normal people can't multitask. That's why texting while driving is so darn dangerous, because it's multitasking. You know, just don't do it. Another thing I have trouble with is remembering long strings of verbal instructions, so I've got to get things written down. Here's an example of the print kind of jiggling on the page. Common problem I am finding in my design class, if I have 60 students, I will find two that have this problem. And when I show that cattle handling facility where it was like three half circles on a line like this, and I ask them just to draw that freehand, they can't do it. It's nothing to do with cattle. I'm asking them to draw a line and put three half circles on it, and they simply cannot do it. And then I question them, and I find out they hate fluorescent lights. They have trouble driving at night. They see the print jiggling on the page. I send them out sunglass shopping, and I had one girl comes back to me and she said, I got an A on my economics quiz because now the PowerPoint slides and the graphs that the professor's showing are no longer jiggling. Those are some of my books. I don't know how we're doing on time. Let's look at the clock back here. Well, actually, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do something naughty. We're going to take a couple of questions right off the audience here. I'm not supposed to do that, but we're going to do that, okay, right here. And I'll repeat the question.
I appreciate you being here. My question is...
Make it short. All right, let's talk about the oil spill in the Gulf. All right, let's discuss that. I have been following that very closely. I have also had 20 years of experience working in the construction industry, and I have been on projects that will run the sloppy, awful manner that they ran that drilling rig, where you've got bosses pushing to get things done too fast, taking safety devices off of equipment, cutting corners. I've been there. And they used a blowout preventer that they knew was broken. That's really wrong. Oil engineers have been presenting papers at scientific meetings saying that with the new deep wells that the ram shear, that's the thing that will cut the the pipe and seal the well wasn't strong enough to cut the new heavier pipe. They were running a blowout preventer after the gaskets had been ripped out, and the guys had taken broken pieces of gasket up to the bosses and going, hey, you know, look what came out of the well. The pressure test was messed up. They didn't use enough spacers. It was just carelessness, rushing, push, 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 push. Now, I want to emphasize, we have two issues here. One issue is whether or not we should deep water drill. That's one issue. The other issue is a sloppily, carelessly run project. They are two separate issues, and we need to keep them separate. And that was a terrible, sloppily run project. And I have been on those kind of projects. I've also been on fantastic projects that had wonderful management, and I know what went on that drill shack. It was push, push, push. There was a shouting match that went on in there between the bosses, and being a visual thinker, I would go, no, we need to, you know, stop this thing. I don't care if it costs $20,000 an hour, but I can just hear that boss screaming, it costs us $20,000 an hour to run this rig. You just got to get it done, get it done, get it done, get it done, and use 5 spacers. And Halliburton's saying use 21 spacers. Well, of course, a contractor always wants to use maybe more work than you need, but it certainly ought to be more than 5 spacers to keep the little pipe centered in the big pipe. The other thing is the things that caused this to fail were not complicated things conceptually. You're talking about a broken gasket. You're talking about a blade not strong enough to cut a pipe. You're talking about keeping one pipe centered in another pipe. Hydraulic systems that are broken. This is stuff that 5th and 6th graders can understand. You know, it was simple stuff. But you see, for a visual thinker, I'm like going, well, how could they do that? Now, I think part of the problem is you get bosses that are very abstract. They're too far away. They're just looking at the numbers. They're looking at the $20,000 an hour. And they're not thinking about what happens if you break the well and you've got a mess of monumental proportions. And I have a friend that has a friend that runs 5 drilling rigs. And she says, I put baffles in my hoses so I don't even drop the hose oil into the ocean. And they're livid. The responsible people in the industry right now are livid about that. It was carelessness, rushing, and push, 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 and cutting corners. Well, the whole thing is absolutely horrible. And then you've got all this oil that's like underneath the water, and who knows what that's going to do. It's an absolute disaster. And if the job had been run in a responsible manner, it probably would not have happened. Okay, right here, real quick.
What is the one piece of advice that you would give to a parent of an autistic
child? All right, one piece of advice for a parent of an autistic child. I'm going to have to make this 3 pieces of advice depending on age. If it is a young child, 2, 3, and 4 years old, they've got to get at least 20, 25 hours a week of one-to-one instruction from an effective teacher. You know, and everybody's going to argue about what type of therapy to use, but everyone will agree an effective teacher, one that gets progress. The worst thing you can do is nothing. I do talks around a lot of different places, and you have a whole lot of places down in other parts of the country where there's no services at all. I tell people to go to their, you know, the church or the synagogue group or whatever. You get some grandmothers, you get some students. You got to work with that kid. Okay, now let's say you got a little older kid. On the higher end of the spectrum, I want to develop those strengths. If he's good at art, develop art. If he's good at math, let's develop math. Let's figure out how we can get him into jobs. And then, of course, you've got people that are more severe. Also, people need to understand these sensory issues. If a kid's screaming at the local supermarket, it may be sensory. If every trip to the supermarket or noisy restaurant that's got like 5 TVs going on at once is a screaming fit, that's probably sensory. People need to understand the sensory problems. I've been talking about sensory problems for years. I think it's hard for normal people to imagine a noisy restaurant that doesn't bother them actually might be hurting their ears like being in the middle of the boiler factory. We also need to be doing a lot of research on sensory issues. Social skills need to be taught. Boy, that's one thing in the 50s, that was pounded in. Yeah, combing my hair with my fork at the table, that wasn't allowed. I wasn't allowed to do that. Okay, quick one right there.
I guess I'm one of those people that only thinks in words, and I didn't realize until I was in college that people could visualize. And I guess I wondered if you could say something about that. I find that society is very visual. They say, do you see what I'm seeing?
Okay, so you don't think in pictures at all. I have found that there's a few people that when I ask them, let's say right now, in your mind, I want you to go up to the front door of your house, open your front door of your house, walk around in your house. Most people will see that. But there are a few people that don't at all. And they're rare, but they do exist. And you're probably about the fifth person that has that. One of the ladies I talked to that was a total verbal thinker, an auditory thinker, she was a speech therapist. That's one of the reasons why she went into that field. What field are you in?
I was a social worker.
You're a social worker? Okay, that's something where you don't need to have visual thinking. Okay, let's see. We got to make sure we keep things somewhat on time. We got a few more minutes here before we got to quit. 10 minutes? All right, we're going to take a question from this red lady with the red sweater right there. What gives us the most hope for a common future? That's a really hard question to answer. We've got to work with our young people to figure out how to solve problems. We're having a real problem today with what I call abstractification. Everybody is fighting over the ideology, and they've forgotten about how do we actually fix healthcare on the ground, for example, or how do we actually deal with a problem like energy problems and things like this. You know, what bothers me today is that too many people, they get interested in an issue. I don't care whether it's the environment or it's animals. I don't care what the thing is. And they say, well, let's be a lawyer and we're going to just sue stuff. Well, but that doesn't fix it. We've got to get back to figuring out how to actually fix things, not just cause a massive gridlock where nothing gets done. And some of the people that may be the heads that can figure out just how to fix stuff, some of the, you know, the geeks and the nerds and some of these kids. What do they do with geeks and nerds in China and India? Computer school, engineering school. We need to be doing a lot more of those kind of things. Okay, I've got to take people up close. We're going to hear them. What was the best thing that my mother ever taught me? Well, she taught me manners. She taught me the importance of being nice. You know, there was a lot of training on rudeness. Like, you know, when the fat lady got stuck at the check stand at the supermarket, I was not going to point and laugh at her. You know, that's not nice. The other thing is, she always was pushing me to do new things. Like when I was really young in elementary school, she got me to sing at a professional level. I sang America Beautiful at an adult concert. You know, she was always, you know, got me the little sewing job. She arranged it for me to go out to my aunt's ranch. And at first, I was kind of scared to do some of these things. And she said, you have a choice. You can go to the ranch for 2 weeks or all summer. You've got to push these kids some. You absolutely have got to push them. Otherwise, they just aren't going to develop. You know, you can't push them into a bunch of multitasking and sensory overload. You've got to be somewhat careful about that. But on the other hand, if you don't push them some, they're not going to develop. You know, when I was a very young kid, I was like, I'd ride my bike downtown to Woolworths to buy a kite, you know, by myself. You know, you've got to do things. I was taught basic shopping stuff. I'm seeing young autistic kid, 12 years old, really high functioning, when he stops at a convenience store and he throws merchandise on the floor. I wouldn't have done that. He was plenty high-functioning enough to not be throwing candy on the floor at the convenience store. You know, again, I tend to go back to specifics. See, everybody here asks me, what's the single turning point of your life? There is no single turning point. It's a whole lot of gradual learning. You see, and I'm giving you specific examples. See, I don't think absolute specifics. There are a few important things. Early educational intervention, and I got that. By the time I was 2.5 years old, I was in a little speech therapy school, and unfortunately the movie didn't show the first doctor I went to, a neurologist named Bronson Crothers, when I was very, very young, that got me started on the right track. And then that doctor in the movie, he's sort of a composite of people that wanted to put me in an institution. But you got to do the early intervention, develop strengths, got to teach basic social rules. Those are just a few of the really important things. Okay, right here. You have to make it very, very quick. Sorry. No, because I've got 1,700 people sitting here. I can't carry on a one-to-one conversation with you. I'm sorry. So I have to have a very small... When I, well, okay, and you were asking about the accuracy of the movie. It's very accurate in terms of showing my jobs. Now, there were some events that were changed around. There was some... Well, how I sounded and looked, that was accurate. And in terms of showing autism... especially pre-medication. I've been on medication for 30 years. Just one little antidepressant. It was very clinically accurate, like showing the visual thinking, showing the anxiety, showing sound sensitivity. That was real accurate, showing all my projects and things, visual thinking. But there were some events that had to be compressed and fictionalized, otherwise I couldn't make a movie work. It's a two-hour movie. You can't, there's a limit to what you can put in it. Well, I'm sorry. Oh, because they're restoring a movie from the 40s and they need to make it. Okay, if you're really, you know what you need? Maybe you need to go into film restoration. I'm really sorry. Maybe I can see you later on in the screening room. I think we have time for two more really quick ones and then it'll be time because they want to try to keep it on time. Global meat consumption. One of the things where I think there is a definite place for animal agriculture is getting ruminant animals out on pastures. There's an awful lot of land where about the only thing you could do with that land is to put ruminant livestock. That's going to be cattle, sheep, goats. And I've been very interested in a lot of these pasture rotation programs where you get the cattle or the sheep to mimic how the wild animals grazed. You'd have a herd of cattle or wildebeest come into a small area, they mow it, move on to the next area, and you can quadruple the carrying pasture to the pasture, because what you're doing is you're making the livestock mow it and not just cream off the cake and the candy and leave the less palatable things. How did what? Well, I don't know. Why did you ask me, how do I get so smart? All I can say is you got to study hard. I've gotten one thing that makes me very happy. I've gotten a lot of emails about the movie, and all I can say to like young students is study hard. When you're in college, you need to be thinking about career plans. But sometimes career plans can change. You know what my original career plan was? I wanted to be an experimental psychologist, and I wanted to study optical illusions. Why does the visual system see that room as not being distorted? I was just fascinated by those things. But then I went to my aunt's ranch. And sometimes there's things that come up and that changes things. But study hard, develop your strengths, get involved in lots of other activities. And I think we got time for one more question right there. Okay, the question concerned being an animal lover and going into the field, it was difficult. The scene in the movie with the bull testicles, that actually happened. And all of the male chauvinist piggery, that stuff happened. But the thing that kept me going, and it was really horrible abuses of livestock, I don't think I want to go into all the gory details, some of the bad stuff that people did, and it was really bad. But the thing that kept me going, even back in the 70s when I started, there were some people in the livestock industry that were really, really good. Like Bill and Penny Porter at Singing Valley Ranch. They raised Hereford cattle, and they handled these cattle beautifully. Also, the feed yards that we had in Arizona were not muddy. I'm going to maybe just go back to this horse picture. This computer's having a nervous breakdown, making it go fast. But okay, that actually is a picture of a feed yard in Arizona. It's very dry there, so you didn't have mud. They also had shade. So when I was looking at feed yards, I wasn't looking at big mud pies. When Michael Pollan went and visited his steer at a feed yard, it was like a foot deep in mud. So I could see the cattle actually could be done right. And all the cattle in Arizona, they had shades. You know, I show this in some other parts of the country, and people say, well, what's that thing, that structure up there? I said, well, it's called a shade. And I have been a big advocate that there's a bunch of other places in the country that need to start building shades. But I could see that even though there were people doing bad things, there was just enough people doing stuff right that I could see that there was a way to fix things. Well, I probably gotten to the end of my talk now, and I want to thank everybody for coming, and however wants to come over to the...
Folks, because we have so many of you in here, and there's only 200 seats in the screening room, and we do have folks already waiting there, we're going to let Temple take a few more questions in here, and then we'll still convene to the screening room.
And then we do the books in there, I guess. Yeah. Okay.
So you can take 10 minutes.
All right, I can take a few. Okay, with a light in your hand, with a phone. I can't hear you. Sorry. Oh, okay.
I'm studying designing spaces for people with autism. And I was wondering, how do you handle new urban environments, especially when driving?
Okay, the question concerned spaces for people with autism. The single most important thing that I want to get rid of, like in a classroom or a workspace for people with autism, and also some other disorders, not just autism, is 60-cycle fluorescent lights. Because you can see the flicker. Now, there's some new fluorescents that have a faster cycle rate, and they may be okay. But, you know, how can you study your work if it's flashing on and off like a discotheque? Now, some people have problems with a lot of contrast in the environment. Like my dyslexic student, who's the auditory thinker that had visual problems, the Denver airport out on the concourses doesn't even have fluorescent lights, but she got all spaced out there because as you walked along the concourse, you go by the picture windows and you got to strut every 8 feet. And walking by all those, the aluminum struts, you know, in those windows was sort of kind of freaking her out, you know, kind of the alternating pattern of that. I was somebody where having a lot of bright decorations on the wall, I would have loved that. But there's other people where a lot of stuff like that would be bad. So I'd want to like maybe make the walls rather bland. And if I got the kind of kids that like decorations, then I could put them up. But I don't want something like striped walls. But the fluorescent lights, that's the big thing. And I hope they get some fluorescent lights invented that get rid of the problem, because unfortunately, fluorescents are very energy saving compared to incandescent lights. So a simple thing you can do if you're stuck with fluorescent lights is put a 100-watt incandescent lamp next to the kid's desk. Also use a laptop computer, because that screen doesn't flicker. Some of the flat panels flicker. I'm not sure about the high-def TVs. I don't have somebody to test them on right now. Okay, right there. That's an interesting question. The question was, when I'm visually thinking, does it interrupt my train of thought? No, it doesn't, because thinking in pictures is how I think. You see, that's how I think. And the reason why I have all these door symbols was that when I was trying to think about something abstract like my future when I was in high school, I couldn't get my head around it unless I actually like thought about an actual physical door. I don't do door symbols so much now anymore because I have so much information I have in the internet that's in my head. See, since it's bottom-up thinking, I've got to fill up the internet that's inside here, so the Google that's inside here has got stuff to search. But it is how I think. I've had teachers say, how can I get the pictures out of this student's head? Well, you can't. That's how I think. If I don't bring up the photorealistic pictures, I don't think. It's that simple.
Oh.
Okay, the question was, how does a visual thinker communicate better with the verbal learners? That's something where I've been getting, you know, better at that. You see, when I write, I describe the pictures in my mind. Certain kinds of writing I'm really good at, like writing directions on how to do something. Because as I write the directions, I'm seeing it. Then there's other things where I'm doing something more conceptual, I'll leave out detail. You know, this is something that when you start thinking about thinking, what you need to do is find a friend of yours that's really verbal and just sit down and talk about thinking. How do you think about something really concrete like painting a bedroom or, you know, painting a house? How do you think about things that are more abstract? I had somebody ask me, well, what do you think about capitalism? Okay, now I can get stupid associations that I know are wrong, like I'm seeing the capitals now of different states. That's completely wrong. But what I started pulling up is like pictures from different countries that sort of have different levels of different types of government, going from capitalistic, socialistic to dictatorships to war and chaos, and then sort of like looking at these pictures. So even something very, very abstract like capitalism, I still think about in pictures. You know, it still has to be specific examples, and they can be subcategories of that. I can't, everything still has to go back to specific examples, and that's a real question that I got asked at a book signing one time.
Like yourself, I have an agricultural background. I went to Michigan State on the back of an Angus Grand Champion steer. I'd like to know if your early ranch experience was exposure to animals on the ranch
Well, the question was, did my ability with, you know, working with animals stimulate me emotionally? Yes, it did. I think working with animals is a, you know, it's a really good thing. And I was an absolute horse fanatic when I was in high school, you know, showed horses and you know, activities with animals can be really good. And there's a lot of people that are visual thinkers and don't get hung up on these diagnostic labels. These diagnostic labels are not precise. In fact, right now, for the DMS-5, they're thinking about taking out the Asperger's designation, just calling everything, you know, different levels of autism. You know, nobody sits in a conference room and says, well, we're going to change the diagnosis for tuberculosis. I mean, tuberculosis is tuberculosis, or malaria is malaria. See, those are things that are very definitive diagnoses, where these other things are kind of behavioral profiles. And my background's hardcore neuroscience, and I can't wait until we get into much more brain-based ways of diagnosing things. But activities with animals are really good. I have talked to parents where their young child was in therapeutic riding. I've had 4 or 5 parents tell me their child said their first words while I was on a horse. And when you're riding the horse, there's 3 good things that happen. You can do balancing activities, which is really good for the brain. You do rhythmic activities, and then there's an emotional relationship with the animal. There are some kids who are having service dog is absolutely the best thing that you can do. And then it might be another child where service dog's not appropriate because the kid is very sound sensitive, and if the dog barks, he's afraid of the dogs. He never knows when it's going to bark, and it might hurt his ears. So you have a situation for one kid on the spectrum, a service dog would be absolutely the best thing you can have, and for another child, it would probably be a bad idea. So I tell parents, well, try out the next door neighbor's lab first. And all right, that's a question I get at every meeting. Is there more autism today, or is it just diagnosed more frequently? On the mild end of the spectrum, the geeks and the nerds and the Asperger's, they've always been here. I can think of kids that I went to elementary school that be labeled Asperger today. And one of the things that really frustrates me is where are all the old Aspies? Most of them are employed. And I think some of this gets into 50s and 60s upbringing. And now where I think there is an increase, a real true increase, is some very severe autism, especially this regressive autism, where the child seems to have a little language and then around 18 months to 2, he loses it. There's a regression. And it's been documented in the scientific literature that the regressions actually are real. And I think that subgroup has increased. Why? Okay, that's the $64,000 question. Why? I read these things about plasticizers in the water, then there's the concerns about vaccines and things like this. One of the things that needs to be looked at is this regressive group needs to be studied separately from the non-regressives. I was not a regressive. Mine would have been purely genetic. I didn't have any of those vaccines when I was a little kid. Too old to have had that. And my words came in a few stressed words at a time where it gradually got better. I wasn't one of the echolalic kind of kids. But we need to take this regressive groups where there seems to be a loss of language, where they regress, and we need to study them as a separate group. And I think that will answer a lot of questions. If you just blob it all together, all the different kinds, you're going to get so much variance in the data, you're not going to find anything. Okay, that's a good question. Can visual thinkers become verbal thinkers and vice versa? Visual thinking is a continuum. And there's no way you're going to make me into a totally verbal thinker or make a person that's not very visual into a total visual thinker, but I think you can move it some. Because when I ask the question about the church steeple or about the boats, a lot of people get this vague, generalized outline. But then if I told them, think harder, then they can go specific. So let's say this is a continuum. Let's say I'm on this end as extreme photorealistic visual thinker. On the other end is you right there, and this lady right here in the tan dress, you're on the other end here. Now, there's no way I'm going to take me here and move me to here. That's not going to happen. But you could maybe move me to here, or maybe I can move you to here. Or you take somebody that's in the middle. I can move them some this way, I can move them some this way. There's a lot of brain plasticity, but there's also some innate traits there too, and they interact together, and you're not going to make me from here to here. Not unless you did something physical to the brain that I wouldn't allow anybody to do. Horse slaughter. Well, this is something where you had people that are very well intentioned, but we've had some real problems. There's a lot of horses around right now. Since they shut those plants down, you get thousands of horses going to Mexico, where we have no control. You got them going up to Canada, and there's been some problems up there. Those are the luckier ones. The problem is they got their wish and they shut the plants, but they didn't think about the fates worse than slaughter. Like people throwing a horse out in the desert and letting it starve, there's been some of that. We've got to, they didn't think about what the alternative was going to be. They go, ooh, icky, slaughter horses. But they didn't think about what to do to replace the slaughterhouses with. This gets back to the whole implementation, implementing things that actually work. You know, a better approach would be to try to figure out ways to, you know, cut down on breeding. There's a lot of extra unnecessary breeding of horses. Do that. Because there are horses that have gone to fates worse than slaughter. We're getting a problem now as people get further and further away from practical things where we're not thinking about, okay, we pass some law, we do something, what's going to actually happen down on the ground? And going down to Mexico to some horrible plant that stabs in the back of the neck would be worse than going to even a bad plant in the United States. Yep. Okay. Well, that's you're asking me how people with different abilities can work together. I think you have to just start out on a small scale. Like I had a student that was very, very good at all the record keeping stuff and running the statistics package, stuff that I'm not the very best at, but I was really good at thinking up the experiments. And we made, and figuring out creative ways to look at the data in another way. That's two people working together. What I hope I've done tonight is to get you thinking about some of these things, that there are different kinds of thinking. You see, until the early 90s, I didn't know that my thinking was different. until I asked the church steeple question, and I found all these speech therapists at these autism meetings that just got these vague images. And then I found a lady that was like you, where there was no pictures at all. And you do drive. I just got to make sure you do. No, do you drive? Drive a car. Okay, I have to ask that question because I got to make sure that that it's has to do with visual thinking, and don't have something wrong with your eyes. So you do drive. No, but driving. Drive. Well, people that are not visual thinkers usually don't draw good. And people that have this problem where the print shakes, when they go to draw the three half circles, they got lines going all over the drawing, just all a big mishmash just everywhere. Okay, right here. What could you do to become more of a visual thinker? One of the things, okay, give me an example of something, a verbal concept, and I'll try to give you some ideas of how to think about it maybe more visually. All right.
Here's an example. I would not know what color somebody's eyes are unless I say to myself, she has blue eyes, he has brown eyes. They could be my best friend for years, and I would not know.
Now, when I thought she was saying right there, you're saying, okay, like Joe has blue eyes and Sam has green eyes, let's say. But that has to be verbally. Now, I'm thinking about people I know, and I'm seeing them. I see the person, and then I look at the eyes. You know, and I'm seeing, then I'm also getting off the subject and seeing the guy working out in the shop or something, which has nothing to do with the eyes. The thinking more verbally, one of the things that's helped me is I have to do sometimes more explaining. You know, I get somebody that's very verbal to read something on my rote, and so now you understand this too. What I wrote. Okay, do I think it's important to have the natural world incorporated in school for autism? I think it's good for all kids to be involved with doing things like gardening and all kinds of hands-on activities. I think it's a shame that, you know, a lot of schools have, you know, they've taken all the, you know, the gerbils out of the classroom and things like this because they're worried about some kids who may be allergic to them. We're just getting too separated from the natural world. There's a great book called Last Child in the Woods by Richard Louv. That's a really, really wonderful book. Because I think one of the problems we got today is people are getting too separated from the natural world, from the hands-on things. I had to do a book signing at Costco where it wasn't like a regular event where you do a little talk and then they come up and sign the books. I had to just sit there for 6 hours at the book table. That was going to get really boring. So I decided to become a voluntary Costco sales associate. And that afternoon I sold 60 books and the rest of the table only sold 5. So, but the thing that I found that was interesting is I'd pick out, you know, in carnival language, it's marks. I'd pick my marks out to approach. And I mainly approached older couples and families, teenage boys. I got teased by too many of those in high school, so I didn't normally approach the teenage boys. And the thing that amazed me was the number of families, young kids I approached. And I'd go up to them and I'd say, I'm a professor of animal science. I have a book about animal behavior. Do you have pets? I didn't say dogs or cats. I said pets. I was surprised at the number of families where they didn't even have a gerbil. In other words, animals just weren't in their life at all. I think that's a real shame. And the thing that we need to be doing, okay, because we've got to get our school grades up and everything, well, let's use the natural world. Let's work mathematics into things. We've got to water the plants with a certain amount of water. You've got to put a certain amount of soil in the pots. You've got to mix in the different parts of the soil and work math and writing into something you're doing with gardening. You know, make it real. Okay, right here. Well, and I think that's really good that more and more people communicating with their animals. But one thing that concerns me, and I'm very worried about this as I go around the dog talks and horse talks, is I'm not seeing enough young people coming in it's kind of discouraging. Most of them are over 40. And I'd like to see more young people, you know, training dogs, you know, working with horses, because who's going to become the next Jane Goodall? You know, and there's very little money now for field research. I talk about this in my book, Animals Make Us Human, because we want to solve some of the problems of the environment and learn more about things. We can't just become a lawyer or a politician that's totally abstractified and separated from everything. Well, thank you very, very much. Yeah, NPR's got a lot of talks archived also. I've got some other talks on TED.com and lots of lectures and things on YouTube, even some livestock handling stuff. All right, maybe we're going to have to break it up now. Okay, well, thank you all for coming, and we're going to have to go over to the other room.